lessons learned. I actually gave a talk somewhat similar to this 3 years ago here called How I Code and Why, and that was a bad name for a talk because if you're looking through the schedule and it's like, I don't care what this guy, why this guy codes the way he does, who's this guy? But that I was really trying to get like examples that stuck with me over time and examples that stick, and finally I decided that at least the right name for this talk is Lessons Learned, and it's the lessons I've learned in my coding. You might have learned other lessons. And I'm trying to, wherever I can, show you the original code that this is what happened and this is why I've adopted this practice. It really should be more of a discussion, not just what I think. I'd like to hear what you people think. So I'm all for hecklers. This is basically my timeline history. I worked for 10 years at a company called Inscriber. If you watch television, you've seen their stuff like Bloomberg TV, where it's got stuff scrolling along the bottom and all the graphics and stuff. They do all this graphics for television. And that led me to work for Adobe for about 10 years. And then I've been at BlackBerry for about 5 years. So I guess I got like 5 more years here. It seems like every decade I switch. When I say thanks, I mean blame. So if you see bad code in these slides that led me to not code that way, it was from one of these places, most likely. Try to hide which one it was, but. I'm missing a slide there. That's strange. Imagine that you have this ton of code, you know, millions of lines of code, and you've got a bug in it, and you're looking everywhere for this bug because it's crashing over here, but you know, something's wrong over here, but it's clearly not where the problem originated. And you dig through all your code and you spend 2 weeks trying to find this code, and finally you find these 2 lines of code. Even before finding these 2 lines of code, I figured out that I need to do A before I do B. And that's what the problem is, because something isn't initialized, there's an initialization problem, and I just need to do A before B. And then I go find where does this initialization happen, and I come to this line of code and it goes, oh, I must do whatever it was, you know, before the thing. And it tells me right here, I must do whatever, Basomatic before Splunker. But to fix my bug, I need to do Splunker before Basomatic. I've just figured this out. I spent like 2 weeks figuring out I need to change this line of code, flip the order. But clearly, it's very important that they're in this order, right? So I'm like, what? How did this code get here? Why, you know, why is this comment say you must do this before that? So I dug into Perforce and like traced it all back, and it's like, who put this code here and why did they do it? And I finally find the, you know, the line, the check-in that put the code in here and put the comment in, and it's to fix a bug. It's like, nope, you got to do this one first. And I'm like, no, to fix my bug now, I got to switch the order. But the order was specifically there to fix a bug. And I'm like, who did this? And it's like, oh, this is my check-in. Like a year ago, you know, there was a problem and the quick fix, you know, sometimes you just got to do the quick fix. This thing's got to go out the door. This has to happen first. And I left a comment saying, you really got to do it this way. And the comment doesn't tell you anything about why you have to do it that way. It just like, it must be. So I had to go through more check-in code to figure out what was the bug that I was fixing, go to the old bug database, we're not even using the same bug database anymore. What was that bug all about? What was the problem? Dig through all that and figure out that bug doesn't exist anymore. So much stuff has changed that this doesn't have to be in the right order anymore. So I can just flip the order and leave the comment saying, it must be in the other order now, which would be really bad. So I fix the order and I put a comment saying, you know, must do this before this, otherwise, you know, these things will happen and bad things will happen if you don't do this. But it left an explanation as to what's going on here. And you can still argue that there's still a fundamental problem with the code base of, you know, you've got initialization problems and there's better ways to fix it and everything. But the thing to me was, my favorite comment word now is otherwise. And so many times in code, people do stuff and it's like, you're checking or you're doing something. It's like, why did you do that? And it doesn't always have to be the word otherwise, but I find that using that word helps a lot of people to remember to put a comment saying, what the heck's going on here? And I actually, like 3 or 4 years after leaving this, you know, both me and the guy who sent me this email had gone off to separate companies, and like 3 years later sends me an email saying, I really like otherwise. I use it all the time now. And I was like, awesome. I got one guy. I convinced one person to use this word, and he finds that everyone's happy with it. And that's his whole, like, that's it. That's his whole email was about that. It wasn't about anything else. Just like, thanks for otherwise. So hopefully, just try it. And I've told it to a lot of people, and I've seen guys who like, okay, I will do whatever you say, and they write comments that are convoluted such that the word otherwise shows up in the comment. And I'm like, no, that's not what I meant. I meant, you know, think about the what's going on. Think about the alternatives and why you're doing this. So it's really just an example of, you know, your comment should say why you're doing something. And, you know, there's this debate about, do you need to comment code at all, right? So this code here, and yes?
How long took you to figure out who wrote the comment?
That took me way too long in that case. It took me like a week to figure out that I was the one who wrote the original comment.
So your source code system cannot just do the annotate and tell which version that has that?
Now we have a lot better, like Git blame and stuff like that. We'll quickly tell you, you know. But at the time, whatever we were using at the time, it wasn't, you know, that was long ago. So, I mean, that's an example from long ago. I've been doing it for years now. This example is from Friday. Like my last day at work before I left, I was like doing a code review, and there was this piece of code here. So everyone understand what this piece of code does? It's pretty obvious, right? Whatever is going on, you know, in the big picture, this takes the first item out of the list and updates it, whatever that means, right? So it's fairly clear what this code's doing. But I came into the code review, and someone had left this comment, basically saying, there's a whole list of things here that need to be updated. Why'd you only update the first one, right? It's like, it's clear what the code's doing, but it's like, why is it doing that? And the guy replied with this giant reply explaining the whole thing. And it doesn't really matter exactly what the details were, and I basically had to take out details so that I didn't give out any non-public information. But it was a giant thing like this. He's like, you know, what happens is you come into this code and you update the first dependency, and then you'll automatically end up coming back into this code, and the first dependency will be gone, and this time you'll be updating the second dependency because it's moved to the first one in the list. So just like the way the code's structured, you only ever worry about the first one and then come back in. And you can argue again about, is that how you should structure your code such that crazy things like that are happening? It's like, that might have been inherent in the problem that, you know, that's how it's going to work. But the thing that got me was, I came to the code review and this was all here, and I said, I basically said, take this comment and stick it in your code, right? Like, why did you reply inside the code review tool with this giant piece of text? Copy. And so my rule is basically, you know, do this. When some guy gives you a comment, reply inside the code. It doesn't have to be just cut and paste exactly that, but like, That was my only thing. And then the discussion went on further as why is it all set up like this. But the rule I have, and this was just the last example of it, is in a code review, someone makes a comment, whether it's I don't understand what this code's doing, or why is it doing this, or whatever the comment is, I almost want to set a rule in my company of the guy writing the code, the author of the code review, isn't allowed to reply inside the code review. It's like, no, just update the check-in, show, you know, fix whatever the comment was. If I don't understand your code, whether it's add a comment or change the structure of the code or something, I mean, maybe I'm a complete idiot and say, I don't understand what's going on here, and yeah, just a comment in the code review tool to clarify something. But the chances are, if I don't understand it and the other guy doesn't understand it, change your code. Don't just reply to me inside the comment. So this is like one of my huge beefs with, I mostly do code reviews, so this is why I tell people to not reply inside the code review tool. Reply inside the code. Any thoughts? I'm going too fast. I realize this. I should be hearing thoughts from you people as I go. Yes?
Do you think it's a good idea to put the question that you're referring to into the code?
The question,
it might be a natural question to ask.
Sometimes, yeah, but I mean, the question is very often, I don't understand what you're doing here, or I don't understand why you're doing it, right? And one was, can you name your stuff better so I understand You know, this function is called update dependency. It wasn't even the, it was called something else that was less clear. And more of, why are you doing that, you know?
I'm intrigued by the assumption of a code review tool. It's a relatively new thing for us. We've had them for about 18 months, 2 years. I'm just curious how many in the room, has this now become a normal that we all have code review tools, or is...
Who uses a code review tool?
GitHub a code review tool?
GitHub, meh, sort of. Well, okay, so who uses Garrett? Anyone use Garrett? And who uses Code Collaborator? I will just solve the argument right now. Use Code Collaborator. It is a good code review tool. Garrett is a good gatekeeping tool. Of the way we have Garrett set up in our office is your check-in doesn't get all the way through the check-in until code review is said okay. So you can't check in code without it being code reviews. But as a code review tool of how they put the... In Garrett, you've got all your code, and the comment is just in line with, like, my meta comment is in line with the code. In Code Collaborator, the comments are off to the side, tagged to the line. And it just, there's so many things about Code Collaborator allows you to mark things as bugs. Garrett is kind of, we actually have our own version of Garrett that I'm hoping that's been pushed back, because Garrett's open source. Because I keep asking for features in Garrett, and every feature I'm asking for is a feature from Code Collaborator. It's like, why don't we just use Code Collaborator? Well, because Garrett's free. It's not free, though, because we spend our resources updating it. But eventually, it'll be my preferred tool.
You mentioned Perforce earlier, too, right? And they have a Swarm, I think it is, right? It's free?
Yes. I
haven't tried it.
Basically, I stopped using Perforce. I used to love. I used to love Perforce.
So, if you advocate like putting an explanation right above a piece of code, are you opposed to really long explanations in code, or are you still a fan of like short and simple remarks on where it should be?
For whether a comment, just to repeat it, whether comments should be short and sweet, or you know, explanation. Here's my version of that comment should be, you know, fairly short. There's that argument of, you know, code doesn't need to be commented. It should just be self-evident, blah, blah, blah. And there's also the problem of people will change the code and not change the comment. So then your comments get out of date. I think if you get comments at this level of explaining what's going on, if this function changes, you're probably going to change the whole thing. Because this is a high enough level comment that all the code nearby is going to get erased, and you're not going to update just the first one. You're going to update the whole list or something. And there's a good chance the comment will go with the code. I think what we're missing often in both documentation of, like, if you've got your API and all your docs for your API, and in your internal classes and all your comments and stuff like that, is the high-level picture. You know, I go look at any, like, I'm in charge of BlackBerry APIs for C++ APIs at BlackBerry. And all the time, it's like, okay, this function gets the X, and so the comment, the code description is gets the X, and it's like, you know, why are we getting the X? Like, what am I going to do with this thing once I get it? Can you mention that? See also this other class over here, because that's probably what you're going to use it with. Like, what's the big picture that this class is useless on its own? It's really meant to be used in this, you know, and you can look at example code and stuff like that, but. I find that there's a problem in, like, where in the code do you comment the big picture comment? Sometimes it's at the top of the file, but then no one sees it. Top of the class is often a good spot, but I don't think there's a right answer yet for that.
But. I think it really depends on, like, the type of code. Like, I've got one place in my code where I'm doing a bunch of logic involving, like, boxes and intersections between boxes, and I have, like, tons of comments with like little ASCII diagrams. Because it's like, it's
big fan.
Because I'm dealing with some geometric thing, and like, it's gonna, if there's gonna be a bug in it, it's gonna be really difficult to sort of figure out where the bug is. But there's other places in my code where I'm doing something where I feel like I don't need as descriptive comments, because the sort of explaining what the code does, it's gonna be more evident just from looking at it.
Yeah.
So I think it really just depends.
I'm not repeating that question. This is the benefit of coming to the conference as opposed to watching videos after.
We're going to edit that part out.
No. It's an advertisement that you should come to the conference. I will say I'm a big fan of ASCII diagrams. I've done a lot of graphic work, so yeah, it's, diagrams are great. The other thing what I'd really like someone to do, there's like, you know, get the idea out there of, I want my IDE to have code review built in. Because sometimes, you know, someone puts up a piece of code to be reviewed, everyone looks at it, and then it goes off, and then the code review is lost, right? And that's one of the reasons I tell people, put the result of the code review, it's got to get into the code. Make sure those comments go into the code, because no one's going to go look at the code review in a year from now to figure out what this code does. You're going to look at the code. But also, sometimes I'm just going through some code of someone else's code, and I see something, I'm like, that's odd, why does it do that? What do I do? Do I email the person? I might not even know who wrote this code. What I'd like to do is leave a comment tagged to that line of code, but I don't want to put a comment in the code that says WTF. Like, that's,
why not?
It's okay, but it's kind of useless because I don't know when anyone's going to answer that. Someone else is going to go look by and see WTF. All they're going to see is someone else doesn't understand this code either. What I'd much prefer is somehow I can mark this. I have a question about this code, and it's kind of in a meta comment, and I want it like as a side channel, a side file to this file, and I want it to automatically look at your code, you know, perforce or Git or wherever, figure out who last touched this file, maybe figure out who wrote that line of code, email to whoever you think ever deals with this file, and say, hey, there's been a new meta comment on this file. Someone doesn't understand something. Like, basically automatically start a code review. And then even later, 6 months from now, I can look at a piece of code and see the history of the code review of, you know, this line of code. What was the discussion behind it? So write that tool for me. Yes?
So I sometimes do that when I find a line of code I don't understand. I hit git blame.
Yeah.
I go to the check-in on GitHub, and I leave a post facto 6 months later comment on that line, but it still emails the person.
Yeah, so yeah, that's the thing. It is possible to use git blame and things like that to somehow contact that person who wrote that code. I just want it to be automatic. I just want it to be built into my IDE so I can just, like, right now, leave a comment, type it in, and it just goes out and pokes somebody in the face with, hey, answer this question. Yes?
So, this is kind of the way that I write code, too, which is nice. Nice to hear somebody else say it. But recently I've been involved with programmers who tend to place a higher value on sort of higher level design documentation. And kind of wondering where you think the boundary line between higher level design documentation and these kinds of comments actually lies.
Well, obviously we want to take the higher level comments into concepts such that it's now into the language. If someone would finish that. To sort of semi-repeat the question, I agree. There is a very high-level concept stuff that needs to live somewhere. The main part, either you have a good code repository thing tool that you can attach other documents to, or you put it at the top of your file so that you know that the code's not getting lost. All the other files might get lost. That code's, you know, I don't know a better place to put it. I would like someplace. I'm going to go here first because I saw this hand first.
Well, come back to Andrew. I think one of the code smells here we have is action at a distance, where there's something outside the immediate context that affects the immediate context. Now, unless the comment is injected here, I'm not aware of that. So, and there's nothing I can do with naming here that will fix that. So, I say it's a code smell. It's not the only reason to do this, but when you see this kind of a thing, that's a good sign that this is a place a comment would be useful.
Yeah, that's a good point. This is definitely a case of there's something else going on outside this code that you need to be aware of. And even my other example of, you know, my init and stuff, that init order was causing a problem thousands of lines of code away somewhere else. And it's like, how do you know? And it might be a code smell in the sense of, fix your code that this shouldn't be happening. But in this case, the problem in this case is that when you try to update a dependency, it actually leaves your app and goes to another app, brings another app to the foreground. So it's like hard to get rid of this problem. And then when the updating is done, it's going to go back to your app. So it's like, unless I have a better update tool, I don't think I can solve it. So in some cases, it's like, it's ugly, but that is the nature of the problem, right? Yes?
I'd like to mention that even if we have concepts, we need a place to put high-level documentation, including some small example how to use a framework. Because often you get the detailed framework documentation, okay, the runtime complexity of this method is that, and it expects that, and dependency graphs. But I want to see something like 10 lines of code. What's the basic usage of it? How do the parts
yes.
play together?
Yeah, and that idea of usage and stuff is, I find that what happens is you write your documentation about your function, saying what it does and what it takes and all this kind of stuff. Then you write tests that show how this function gets used, maybe very bland version of how the function gets used, and then you write, you know, usage. I mean, I'm writing a public API, so I have to write usage examples and everything. But I end up writing the same. I write the same thing three times, in some sense, right? And it's like, why can't I make my tests be my documentation and be like, why do I have to do it three times? Can I somehow merge those into one thing? Of this is how it's used, here's the usage, it's all in one spot, and it though that usage is also the test, you know,
well,
some of the tests.
Is, in Python, you don't need the boilerplate of includes and the main method.
Yeah. Yay, let's go, let's continue. I have no idea what I wrote next. These are the comments you don't want, right? It's like, yeah, I know what the code's doing. And you see that all the time. It just drives me nuts. That's what I don't want. That's what I want. So tell me why the code's there, not what the code's doing. I can see what the code's doing. And please reply to code review by changing your code. OK. Some people know what this topic is. The Queen of Clubs. Here's the question. Is the Queen of Clubs a object, a kind of a reference semantic type, or a value in a value semantic type? And if you don't know what that means, should I have a copy constructor on say this class? You know, I think this is all pretty much all there is to a deck of cards. A card has a rank, you know, two to ace and a suit, one of those. Great. Should it have a copy constructor, or should it be move only maybe?
It should be an enumeration constant.
Well, should the ranks also be? I mean, I was going to write slides on this part that I hardly write code at home ever because I just don't have time, but I have kids now that have, you know, iPhones and Blackberries and stuff, and they're like, write an app, you know, write the next Flappy Bird, and we'll be rich. It's like, yes, why don't we just, you know, buy a lottery ticket? But I said, okay, I finally sat down one day to write. A card game, you know, it's like, oh, I'll write a card game. And of course, me, I'm like, I'll write a generic deck of cards that can play any card game, you know. But I started out with, I thought card was a simple class. And then part of the problem is that in your card game, there's only one Queen of Clubs. Should you make a copy of it? It's like, well, there's you shouldn't have two Queen of Clubs unless you've got two decks or something like that. So it's like, I was kind of wondering about that. And basically, in general, this is for people, I think most of the people here know, I'm using different terminology maybe, but you know, values, think of ints and recs and strings and Stepanoff and Sean and John Lake was very, people are very pushing on value types are the way to go, and you can avoid pointers, and value types are very mathematical. But objects are kind of important things to have. And if you're doing Java, you have your base class object. And Qt has a Q object as a base class and object-oriented. And they tend to be non-copyable. And there tend to be things. There's things that change over time. They have properties, and those properties have values. But the class is a thing. And maybe they're observable. Maybe they have signals and slots or some other kind of observability. And they have relationships that, you know, this button is beside that other button. And, you know, a button class, do you want to make a copy of a button? Because a button, what's the value of a button? It's like, well, button's an object, it's on the screen, right? Sean probably gonna tell me that everything, all my examples are values. Everything's a value.
Of course, but to your Queen of Clubs is your Queen of Clubs is not mutable, so it doesn't matter.
Oh yeah, that's a good one too. Before we get too many comments on this, because I want to ask before we discuss it, ask something before we discuss. And I have this thing I call the steering wheel problem on reference semantics, in the sense that if you want to borrow my car and I give you the keys of my car and you drive away, do you expect me to also still be holding onto the steering wheel while you drive? Like, well, I've got a reference to the object and you have a reference to the object, so let's both steer the object. And that's why, and especially I had to do a bunch of Java code in the old BlackBerry days, every bug I fixed was because you didn't realize that you passed a reference to somebody and they kept it. And shared pointer. Shared pointer is great except for the word shared in it. Its purpose is to share pointers. And when you share pointers, it's like, how did this class change? Well, the guy over there you're sharing it with changed it on you. Did you realize you were sharing it with the other guy? And it's often a bad thing. But, I mean, it gets rid of, you know, people are afraid of pointers. Shared pointer and unique pointer and QT has parent-child to get rid of managing your pointers. But the sharing is not always a good thing. I'd say it's almost always a bad thing. Whereas math is awesome because if you have a function, you know, set y, and then you call g of x, and then call g of y, do those print the same thing? Well, in value semantics, you know those print the same thing because it was the same value in, you know, assuming you have a regular pure function that doesn't do any side effects. But as soon as you have objects, it's like, does g change the object on me? Does, you know, do those two print the same things? And even the simple case, which we do all the time, is you see some code and you go, oh, this expression is repeated, so I'll make a temporary and then call it. Can you make a temporary? If it's a value type and everything is regular, it's of course you can make a temporary. The temporary you made is this works the same as the original because it's a copy. But if you get references, you're suddenly like, wait a second, did I make a copy of this thing or do I just have another reference to this thing? Yes?
Of course, it assumes that the functions are pure.
Yes, and it also assumes the functions are pure and regular. But well, go once you start living in that world, you'd love that world. It's a great world to live in.
Not pure. Not necessarily pure because they can allocate memory. You just don't care about it. It gets deleted before it returns. That's not pure, right?
The outside view, it's pure.
Okay. Let me summarize. Discussion about what pure means. I think, is it better defined as regular in regular function in EOP?
It's defined as regular in EOP in this function because it includes an action. So you can allow for something to mutate the item so long as if you passed it equal things, it would mutate it in the same way.
Ah. Yeah. Okay, regular just does the same thing.
The actions in pure functions.
So, right. But in this case, so regular is then insufficient to guarantee referential transparency. I cannot do this extraction here because if f is regular and it's allowed to increment f, then there's a difference between calling f twice and f.
Whatever the right term is, This is going off the edge anyhow. My real question is, so before we even discuss it, just by your instinct, if you have any instinct now from understanding what I mean by object and value, or if you just want to think, has a copy constructor or not, show of hands, you have to vote. This is not like a standards committee where you get like weakly in favor and strongly against. No, it's yes or no. Is the Queen of Clubs an object or a value? So who thinks it's an object? All right, who thinks it's a value? Uh-huh.
I can interpret the question both ways. I have to know the context of the question you're asking. Yeah. Is the Queen of Clubs a value? Well, three is a value, where I have many references to the Platonic notion of three. Is this specific card within the deck of 52 cards I am playing this game with an object or a value? It's a different question. And I heard both expressed in the way you asked that.
Yes. So it is depends on the to summarize. It depends on the context and how it's being used and everything. So the problem is, I'm trying to write this class, and part of the thing is, in my rule, especially with the BlackBerry APIs in particular, which are based on QT. If you're in QT, if you're an object, you derive from Q object, and you get signals and slots, and you get the certain mechanism, and otherwise your value type, and it's like. To me, it's the first decision you make on a class. Is this class a value or a reference? Now, that's not always the case, because an int, everyone's like, int is the canonical value type, right? If it works like int, you've got a regular value type. Now, if I take an int and I make it a global variable, guess what? That's reference semantics. because anyone can change that on me. It's now basically become an object, right? Because we all have access to it at the same time. It's not just a value moving through your code kind of thing. So in a sense, it's part of the power of C++ is that I can take any value and make it kind of an object by just taking a pointer to it. It's like, okay, now I've got one queen of clubs, and that queen of clubs is now an object. You know, I've got an instance of that value, it's become an object, and now everyone's going to refer to the same one. But I find the real rule in this example to me is most often you want your class to decide that. This class is a value type and it works this way, or this class is not a value type, it doesn't have copy constructor. So as I'm writing this code, I have to decide. And it's in the context, all I can tell you, it's in the context of a game, right? I'm making a card game.
As you say, it's really easy to take something with value semantics and give it reference semantics just by taking a shared footer to it.
Yeah.
But is it hard to go the other way? I think it is, but I'm not sure.
Is it hard to take something with reference semantics? Well, yeah, it's hard this is the great case that Sean was talking about earlier of you could always have your reference semantic class and have a copy function. And it's like, it's not the copy. It's like, what would you call that copy function? It's like, why didn't you call it the assignment operator in the copy constructor? But people do this. So if you have a class that has a clone method or something like that, it's like, yes, mostly this is a reference type, but you can clone it and then get value semantics. But it's just like, that's just wrong,
yeah.
Right? Like. The object never mutates?
Because queen of clubs, I would contend, is not mutable. So whether or not you store it as a reference to a single instance of the queen of clubs where you copy queen of clubs, the result is the same.
Yeah.
But it matters in the case which Tony is talking about, where if it has reference semantics, if it's an object, you derive from QObject, because then it's automatically mutable because it has a list of signal receivers.
Yeah, but I mean, forget about QObject. In this case, I wasn't using QT in this case. In this case, yes, Sean's point, to repeat it, is that queen of clubs is immutable, never changes. So what difference does it make, to a certain extent, whether it has, it, you know, if it's an object, but it never changes. So the other point I wanted to bring up, you mentioned, is relationships. And I think that is the crux of the problem here, is that the queen of clubs has a relationship to the deck of cards. And has a relationship in that it's in someone's hand, or it's played on the table, or, you know. So you could write that as part of the state of the queen of clubs. Has it been played yet? Is it in, you know, who's its owner kind of thing? I probably don't think that's a good way to do it, but, you know, you could see that coming up. Sometimes that's a good thing to have a pointer to your owner and stuff like that. But I think that is part of the issue with this example is what's the relationships?
Suppose I would argue that the queen of clubs doesn't have a relationship to anything else. The other things have relationships to it. Like decks contain the queen of clubs.
Well, if decks contain the queen of clubs, then the queen of clubs is contained in a deck. How does it not have that relationship?
I think you're trying to say it's not a bidirectional relationship.
Yeah, it's not.
I think there is a relationship both ways, but I think, you know, it's the vector that should maintain that relationship, not the queen of clubs.
Right.
So I think we do agree, but, you know, in saying, is there a relationship there? I think it's there, both ways. I mean, relationship is external to both parts. It's its own thing between the two. And the question is, who maintains the relationship? Sometimes it's one of the two parts can maintain it. Sometimes it's a third party that maintains the relationship between the two parts.
But yeah, you can do that with with a queen of clubs that has either object or value semantics, doesn't really matter. But if you start out with a queen of clubs that has object semantics, if you build that into the queen of clubs, you can't then get value semantics out of it when you want to do things like do an alpha beta search on what if I had the queen of clubs in my hand. I can't actually get a queen of clubs.
That is exactly, I mean, well, to summarize, his first part is, and someone else, yet we talked about this yesterday at the bar or whatever, someone else mentioned the same thing of, well, just have, you know, a singleton, which is your deck of cards. So, you know, each one exists once and you have unique pointers to them or whatever. But yeah, your other comment of when I'm doing an AI for my card game and I want to say, what if I had the queen of clubs? Or what if the other player has the queen of clubs? Or what if I get the queen of clubs? Now I need a copy of the queen of clubs, at least virtually. You know, it's not the queen of clubs in the card game, but it's this queen of clubs, it's the value of the queen of clubs. And you also have another interesting thing, which maybe I can talk about later, but without going too much off on a tangent, is queen of clubs is a value in the sense of the king of clubs is greater than the queen of clubs, probably in your card game. You know, you get some interesting things going on there as well.
So it's also arguable whether the idea that there can only be one queen of clubs is actually a fixed rule. Because, I mean, sure, if we have a physical card deck, yes, there's just one queen of clubs. But if you implement this on a computer, you can play any card game with that. What if I invent a card game that only works on a computer because you can duplicate cards?
Yeah, yeah. Well,
a game that has two decks in one.
I mean, the card game I was writing actually had allowed two decks. But it actually has, you know, the three of clubs is the first card played. And if you have two decks, you have to decide which, you know, because you don't know who has the three of clubs, so you don't know who starts. So you say, okay, the three of clubs of the red deck, whatever. So my class actually had three parameters in it. It had a deck. Which deck am I? Just because I needed to differentiate. But
the point is, it's a part of the rules of the game that only one queen of clubs can be in play. That's a matter of the rules of the game.
Yeah, so I started out trying to write a specific game and then trying to write a deck of cards. But I agree, if you throw away that rule of there can only be one queen of clubs, well, maybe you can get a whole new set of games. And like yesterday someone mentioned, like, when you're trying to do AI of, well, what if I had the queen of clubs? Then you're just like, well, what's the probability of me getting the queen of clubs or something like that? Well, then I could have cards with probabilities in them. And then it's like, well, can I write games with cards with probabilities? Like, what's in my hand? Well, I have a 90% queen of clubs in my hand, you know? I don't know what that means yet, but, you know, you could, yeah. As soon as you get virtual, you've extended the set of things you can do, right? Because it's not a card game anymore. It's own thing.
So what's the answer?
What's the answer? Yes. Because I was writing this. I had to come up with an answer. And my rule is, this is the answer. Someone spilled water on my laptop. Yeah, not this laptop, my home laptop, and that code is in there. So I think the hard drive's still okay, so I can pull the code out. But really, the rule, the guideline I'm trying to tell you here is make backups of your code. I was very close to the point of having. So one thing I want to mention more clearly of, if you make the Queen of Clubs a value type. And then enforce reference semantics by always passing around unique pointers or something like that. What I was trying to avoid was accidentally making copies. It just felt weird when I was passing Queen of Clubs to a function and I was like, it was making a copy and I'm like, why, how, like, you shouldn't be making a copy. So either I always use unique pointers or I wrap unique pointer inside the class itself. So I'm typing less and it's, you know, more abstract as to what I'm doing. I was very close to the point of having two classes. There was the object card and there was the card value. And the card object has a card value. And because sometimes you want to use the values and sometimes you want to use it as an object. And then water got spilt on my laptop.
And of course, card value could be a base class and a probability
card. Yeah. It's a concept. Card becomes a concept. And you've got floating point cards and The other interesting thing, which I didn't have slides for, was the rank. So rank is an integer, right? And I was like, because you can add queen to seven. Does that make sense? Because, you know, you can add two ints. And I ended up writing an ordinal class that has order, because I still want seven is less than queen, but I don't want adding. But then it turns out I did want to know something that's one greater. And then as soon as you get that, it's like, okay, adding's showing up here. It's all like, you got successor, you've got all of math, but...
If you play blackjack, you want to have the ability to add that.
Possibly.
If you play blackjack, then there's a card that has two possible ends.
Oh.
And you do want
to
add them. Because the ace can count as one or as 11,
yeah,
depending on how it's useful to you.
Yeah. You've got lots of rules. Yeah, and blackjack is a game where you do add them up.
And if you play schnapps, the German game schnapps, and then suddenly the 10, it doesn't have anything below 10, but the 10 is worth more than the jack, queen, and
yeah,
the
even in this game, the twos, I mean, twos are wild kind of thing. Like, you know, so it, at some point, the value and the, and it's a case of the, if I want a less than operator on my class, it's like, it depends what game you're playing. Right, it's almost like the less than is a runtime.
It's kind of a function of the deck too, because in some games there are no two of clubs, for instance.
Yeah,
those cards are really the deck. So there's really all of those functions are your context, which amounts to.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I started out writing a very specific game, and then clearly the questions I started asking myself when it became a more generic game. But I would really love to have. I mean, first of all, a deck of cards is bang for the buck. Think about that. Think of like how much it costs to go see a movie, and it's like 2 hours, and then that money's gone. Deck of cards is like $5, $2, whatever. There's a deck of cards, man. That's fun. That's fun for ages, right? So I was like, if I could write a deck of cards on my phone, and then somehow play any game you want, and be able to like download the rules of the game, or even if it's just the people playing, like a deck of cards doesn't have the rules inherent in the game. The people just play by the rules, right? It's like, there's so many options of what you can do with a deck of cards.
Are you proposing a new library in a week?
Yes, library in a week, deck of cards. And for the bang for the buck of cards, it turns out the bang for the buck is probably having friends. And, like, the deck of cards is not where all the value is, but, you know, it's... Solitaire, play solitaire and stuff, yeah. Yes?
Conceptually, isn't it more like 52 different values and all the relationships are defined sort of like a locale based on the ordering and sorting?
Yes, in some games, clubs are better than diamonds and stuff like that. So yeah, in some sense, it's just 52 different values ordered based on this game. And order even might change halfway through the game because someone played the eight of clubs and now we're going left to right and blah, you know. So, I mean... Having the chance of having a good less than is probably really low, and it's going to be very specific functions for every specific case. So to me, the real thing is not just make backups. It's when you write a class, first thing I think about is this. Is what's going on here? Is this some object in my mind, or is this a value in my mind? And I lean towards value most of the time. It's nicer. But... you know, a button class. Button feels like an object to me because there it is. You don't make copies of button. The OK, you know, in your functions, do you make copies of the OK button? What value does the OK button have? You know, it's like, it doesn't have a value, it's just there. It's got properties of what its position and it belongs inside this container and stuff like that. I don't, but anyhow, unless there's more questions on that. I was writing, this isn't code I was writing. I've seen this kind of code over the years, you know, way too often. Like, at least once a year I see code where someone's got a hard-coded table of some kind, and then during init, they run through the table and put it into a map. And then this last time I saw it, they put it into like three maps because it's like table in all directions and stuff. But just even the simplest case of just, I've got a table of keys and values, and it's there, and you know what? It's already sorted by the programmer, and yet they walk through it and put it into a map. So they're making all these allocations and stuff. And I was like, you've got a sorted container here. Why don't you just do a binary search on it instead of, and it's like an immutable map. It never changes. It's hard-coded in the code, right? So more than once, I've written a class called static map that's just for this case. It's like, give me your hard-coded array, and I'll make something that looks like a map and acts like a map. You can't add, it's immutable. And basically, the last version of it turned into sorted view. And the point of it is mostly just for this find function, because I don't trust you to write binary search. You know, you shouldn't have to write it over and over again. Or I don't even trust half my programmers to use binary search correctly. So it's like, here, I'll wrap this all up for you, and then you can just use it. But I don't want to talk about how binary search works, because that's not as exciting as... This is the thing that bothered me, is this assert. When you construct this sorted view, it's only going to work if your stuff is actually sorted. So maybe I should assert that it's sorted, that, you know, catch any bugs that you did. But this is this class of mine that I want to hand out to everyone on my teams, and that's like everyone at my company. There's thousands of developers. How many people here have written their own assert or use a different assert macro than the standard assert? You know, because your framework, your code base, whatever says use something else, right? Yeah, all of us almost, right? So it's like, I don't like just calling assert when I know every team I hand it to are going to be like, can you call our assert instead? And I might even have my own assert in my library. But I think I want to call your assert. Why do I want to call your assert, not my assert? Yes?
Because you have different error propagation mechanisms that work with your unit test suite.
Yeah. And what do I mean by your assert and my assert? I should repeat that it was error testing, suite testing, which is a good answer for why.
My assert is probably vanilla assert. Your assert, or Alistair's assert, is probably
DSLS assert. Yeah. In this context, I am the writer of sorted view. You are the guy using sorted view. So I don't want to call my assert here. I want to call your assert because it's your bug, right? If this thing isn't sorted, it's your fault. So I want to call your assert mechanism, and you deal with it, right?
Template argument?
Yeah, template argument. How about this one? How about sorted view has its own assert, and you just pound define sorted view to be my assert if someone else didn't already include it to use their assert? And that works if ODR violations means works, undefined behavior works. It actually, you know, because it gets inline, it kind of usually works. But, you know, if three people use this class and they all do different asserts in it, then you've got three different versions of this function. Technically, it's ODR violation.
Wrap it in inline
namespace. Yes, I think there's lots of ways around. You know, make a template somehow. And I've tried some of those. I think I did try using a template once to do it. I had this where I made sorted view or whatever derive from a base class that basically you had to supply of the stuff I need that isn't pertinent to sorted view. Give me the assert, the framework that you want me to work with. I'll derive from that framework. And maybe Bloomberg and they have a good answer to this, where the assert framework has a way to hook into it so that how you handle that assert is different from how the other guy handles it. In the sense that the good part of that is I can write my code and know that every framework can be hooked in however you want, and it's up to main to decide how it's hooked in. But the problem is still, if I just hand this code to people, they all have to be using that framework. If that framework gets put into the standard, you know, which is the people are trying to do, then I can hand out my code and say, look, I'm using the standard assert handler, insert your own assert handler, or whatever it is, and I can make my code work for everyone again. But I was stuck on this, wanting to call your assert, and eventually I decided on this. I'm not going to call assert. I'm going to force you to call assert somehow. And what I really want is this. You're going to create a sorted view, and you'll call assert sorted on your container, and you're the one calling assert, and somehow that will construct a sorted view. Do you want to point out the errors in this slide? Sorted view is a template. There should be template parameters there. Yeah, template args over there. So I'll just say this is purposely pseudocode to fit on slides. This is not a bug. Geez. Yeah.
Well, maybe you declared it inside a member of Sorted View.
It may be. Yeah. Where is this code living right now? Who knows? This code. Well, you could have angle bracket auto or something, you know, right? Because I don't want to type in what the iterator and the sentinel is. It should come from here. It should know what it is. So anyhow, I want to do this is force you to call assert sorted, or maybe you call assume sorted, which does no checking at all. Just like, trust me, it's sorted. I'm not even going to, even in debug, I'm not going to check if it's sorted. Or maybe you've got a function like ensure sorted, which checks if it's sorted and then sorts if it isn't, and you know, which sounds like a weird function, but it's actually turns out to be a useful function. Or maybe you want to call sort, and well, once you've called sort, you know it's sorted. So if sort would return something that gave me the information that this is sorted now, so I've written my own sort basically. Of course, none of this works because the constructor takes two args, and so I need to fix the constructor here. And here's why ensure sorted is a weird case of why you might want to do something very unique in your checking of this function. Because you've got country codes, and that's hard-coded. That never changes, right? Oh, wait a second. You know, in Georgia, border of Russia, there's, you know, maybe a new country. And this starts getting really ugly because, well, what's the name of that country? It's got two names right now. And look, now it's not even sorted anymore, maybe, depending on the if-def. And at some point you start going, do I trust my developers to keep this static table sorted, right? Because ideally, that's what I really want. They've typed it all in, and I want it to be sorted. So what I would really like is, in debug, I want to scream, say, hey, this isn't sorted. Rewrite the code so it's sorted. But you know, maybe they didn't check, maybe these if-defs, maybe in a certain build, no one's checked that build, it's not actually sorted. And it's like, well, you know what, in release, I'm going to log, and I'm still going to scream, but I'm going to sort it for you. Because you know, in release, I really want the code to work still. And later on, you can fix the sorting of your hard-coded table. I'm going to start over there. Yes?
Murphy's Law says you have a bug in your sort routine that will only show up.
Yes, I probably have a bug in my sort routine that only shows up in runtime. That's the other problem. You know, my sort just calls the standard sort.
Yeah, on which fields are we going to sort?
Yeah, I mean, the bigger problem in the case of you want like a map that goes three different ways, then I need to, yeah. Let's just tackle the simple problem of pretend we're only sorting on, say, the first one. You know, maybe country and code has a like primary.
Algeria right there.
Yeah.
It's DZ.
Yeah, the second parameter is not in order at all.
I'm going to raise the same point I did when we were at BlackBerry together, and you raised this at the time, and I said you're going about this completely wrong. The first thing is that you should have no sorting in there whatsoever, because that's completely unnecessary. You should have a statically assembled hash map, which takes the input and will put them into an internally statically at the compile.
Yeah, I should
that
be able.
Hash map then is then looked up, and that way then you have no problems with sorting, none of these problems.
I should be able to do this all at compile time. I should be able to do the sort at compile time.
Did I not put something together for you that demonstrated this would work? Well, I thought I did, and I gave you the code.
Maybe. I think I was trying to write it for even pre C 11.
Yes, that's
C++ 11.
Yeah.
So, you know. And the other thing being, I think the compile time version of sorting this stuff ends up making a copy, right? Like you have to return a value at compile.
I thought we were moving just with const char pointers.
Oh yeah, you could just reference into this table. Yeah. Lots of answers for this. I mean, so the real problem I'm trying to get to is how do I, you know, push the assert into outside of the code and into your code. So I need to fix my constructor. So how I fix my constructor is instead of taking the two params, I take a sort certificate, which holds the two parameters in it. The nice thing about sort certificate is that it has a less. The less type is built into the sort certificate. So you're not just saying this is sorted. You're saying it's sorted with this less operator, you know, because it might not be sorted. I mean, that's partially an answer to your stuff of what thing are you sorting on. And now assert sorted and assume sorted and stuff return a sort certificate instead of returning, instead of, you know, whatever, what, you know, I don't know what I'm trying to say there, so I'll just keep going. Now the question is, what does sort certificate look like? Well, geez, it looks like this. It takes a begin and end, and basically I've gotten nowhere, right? Because sort certificate, if you'll notice, looks a lot like what sort of view looked like originally. So I didn't want you to create sort of views from begin and end, but you need to create sort certificates from begin and end so that you can write your own assert macros or assert functions. You look scared.
No, no, this is actually a really good idea. I mean, this is something that happens all the time. Like you create classes that take preconditions and hold them as invariants and pass those around.
Yes. So I've taken the precondition and I'm trying to make the precondition into a type.
Yeah. It took me a little while to figure out what you really did.
Yeah, no, that's
okay. So, of course, my problem is that the precondition allows you to write this bottom line here, just like, oh, I'll just create a sort certificate from begin end. I'm not doing any checking. It's kind of maybe what assume sorted does or something. I don't want you to be able to do that. I don't want you to be able to create a sort certificate directly. You have to call one of these functions to create one. So make the constructor of sort certificate protected. So you can still create one. You just have to go out of your way to create one. And then this simple code won't work anymore. And then here's my ensure sorted, you know, as an example of one of the functions that returns a sort certificate. It does its checking and maybe does different things in debug versus release and stuff like that. And then it creates internal to the function, it has a derived class from sort certificate and it returns that. And then it gets immediately sliced away and you get a sort certificate out the other side. So I've constructed one even though I couldn't get at the constructor directly. Which all that's saying is, I'm just making it harder for you to create a sort certificate. So I'm just forcing you to think about creating a sort certificate.
No.
I think that's the response I'm looking for. Is what I?
No, I was just confused because I thought that copy constructed would be protected too, and so this should be inviolate.
I retyped this. I actually don't. I've written. This is actually code of. I've written and compiled for a change. Usually my code is written in wiki pages and stuff. But I don't have that code with me, so I just retyped it again. So I could have got it wrong. And the one thing I want to point out to you here is, so now this code is calling your log and your assert because this can be your function. You can write these functions. And more importantly, it's your logic. You decide how much checking you want to do in each particular case. But it's, you know, on the other hand, it's not easy to write this. And so the real point is that what happens with, especially a lot of code I write, is I take my code, and it's very generic code, and I hand it to a team and say, here, use this. But the code requires one guy on the team to adopt it into the team. So you don't want every guy on the team writing this function. You want one guy to go, well, in our team, we would like to check like this, and we would like, you know, this selection of functions and, you know, our asserts, and we'd like to throw, or whatever your team wants to do. I've given you the pieces to do that. One guy on your team adopts my code and adapts it for your working style. And then the rest of the team, most of the team is just going to use sorted view, and it hopefully has got a really nice interface. Its interface is exactly standard maps interface, except for you can't add to it. And I think that's a pattern I find a lot is, especially when you deal with hundreds of teams. Like everyone has their own way of doing things, yet you can still write some generic code that's like, here, this is generic code, but it's so generic it's too complicated to use. And I find the same thing with Boost. A lot of times when we use Boost, one guy on the team adopts Boost into our code base, into this one project, but then they immediately, some of it, depends on the pieces of Boost, gets wrapped up into something that more matches our style. I mean, Boost now has become very ubiquitous such that you don't need to do that, but some pieces of it still, you're just like, I don't want you to look at how multi-index works or something like that. Just here, just look at this nicer looking thing, you know, whatever. So I don't know, do people find this is too far? Like you kind of almost like this idea, but it's like.
I like this idea. I've actually done stuff very much like this for a lot of different things. Yeah.
I mean, my favorite part about this is that the sort certificate has the less type built into it. So it's like it's sorted with this less function, not that less function over there. But
couldn't you just have done that by making constructor in sort of view protected and then templating this the less in sort of view directly?
Can I just make
bypassing the sort certificate, just making the
The question really is, what's the difference at the end of the day between a sort certificate and a sorted view? Because if you have a sorted view, you should be able to, I think I actually ended up doing that, a sorted view has a conversion to sort certificate. Because if you've got a sorted view, well, it's sorted. You know it's sorted because, you know, you had enforced it at some point. There's nothing in this code that forces it to stay sorted, because the view is just a view over a range. So if you mess with the range behind my back, you know, like you can only do so much. But yeah, at some point you're like, what's the difference between sorted view and sort certificate? But it felt to me like it was important to separate them, is that sort certificate can be used in other places as this is, its whole intent is just to tell you, yes, this thing is sorted. What do you want to do with it? You know, maybe there's there could be other classes and other things that take a sort certificate and do other stuff with it. So I don't want sorted view to be used in that context when what you really wanted was just this type. Yes?
So do you have any idea what those other things would be, or is this purely speculative?
That is, I think I had something, I can't remember what. It's mostly speculative as to whether there's any other uses of sort certificate, but that I will just say is gut instinct, that I felt sort certificate is its own thing, different from sort of view. But I did halfway through go, well, a sort of view is, you know, has a begin and end. It's isomorphic to sort certificate. Why do I have two different concepts? But I felt like the concepts were different.
I'm not quite sure why this isn't just a very convenient way to go around, to avoid having an object or a function that just explains the way in which assertions should fail.
A function that explains the way insertions should fail. So how are you, see if I can understand. So you're trying to solve this?
Yes.
What are you going to put there?
Well, you're going to do the test or
is,
not.
Yeah, the is sorted. Yeah.
So that's maybe something that gets provided by the way assertions work objects, whether they're turned on or not. And then if the test fails, you're going to have some sort of diagnostic behavior and you're going to have some sort of recovery behavior.
So I could pass in an assert mechanism, a whole
right.
mechanism.
And if you do that, then when, you know, yes, you've done sorted view, maybe you have reverse sorted view and you have reverse sorted certificates, but you could just use the same assertion mechanism for all of these things that need assertion mechanisms.
So pass around an assertion mechanism. Maybe.
Assert and tell people to
just
add. It's the standard.
Yeah, I mean that's why. So there's two parts to this. One is I set out to solve this problem of, you know, what assert should I be calling, and maybe once if the standard has this further solution from Bloomberg on how to you know a whole assert mechanism. Maybe then I don't have this problem, but I'm wondering if my sort certificate is useful nonetheless, and not just because it avoids assert.
I like the idea of having some kind of type token that just asserts, you know, some property of a thing that you can then pass around, right? Like even in the case where it's not checkable. But I think you want it to be every time you require somebody to write a piece of code, they're likely to get that piece of code wrong with any other line of code they write. So you want the mechanism.
Yeah, this mechanism might be too complicated. The funny thing is that at the end of the day, I wrote the three different assert sorted and stuff
right.
as you can use these if you would like, but you can also write your own. But then the ones that I wrote, I still have the same problem of I don't know what assert to call, but it still felt like I've separated the problem into, I feel a lot of programming is multiple personality disorder of, you know, I, if someone solved this problem for me, this would be easy. So I'll just, you know, and then, like, oh, I'm the guy who's going to solve that problem. Like, it's, you know, if I only had this function, and then oh, I'm going to gotta be the guy that writes that function. But not me now, that's me, other me, you know.
I mean, I like this because I think one of the largest, work in this big runtime system, and one of the largest complaints we get is, you guys use your own asserts and your own exceptions, and we want to do it our way, especially when we're working with another sort of framework and they want to use our stuff. It's just, I sort of like this approach where sort of they can write it and we don't have to write the assert and figure out what to use.
The assert problems always bothered me. That's any solutions I'll be happy with.
The problem with just saying no, there's the standard assert just uses is that the standard assert is bad. Or is bad implemented.
Standard assert is bad.
Because I cannot influence its behavior on Windows.
Right.
Just can, and we have now the problem that that our build server is set up to build everything in release mode. And then we run our unit tests in release mode, and we have all these nice assertions that never fire on our unit.
Yeah, that's the big thing we had is. The thing we had was at some point on Premiere, I think Adobe Premiere, we decided we had our own assertion mechanism and stuff, and we decided to leave it on in release, because, you know, otherwise the end of the day the user gets the program disappeared or something, and it's like, well, you know what, if our assert fires and it comes up with some almost nonsensical message to the end user, at least there was something, you know, that they can report back saying, this is the message I got, and then we can fix it, right? Which is the next topic.
But you can't always leave on your asserts in release mode, because if it's in code, if it's in like scheduler code.
Yeah, there's, I mean, Microsoft had the checking iterators and stuff. That was like, we could not turn that on, because we had just code. It's like, it's too slow to run. Now, it's on by default. There used to be on by default.
Yeah, I really like the sort certificate approach to the abstract problem of how do I ensure sorted, assume sorted. But it doesn't seem to actually do anything to solve the my assert, your assert problem. It just pushes it down one more level into three header files instead of one.
Well, it lets you write your own, you can either use my three asserts, my assert sorted and stuff, or you can write your own assert sorted that does whatever you want.
Yeah,
but yeah,
if
you're...
If I want to write more code, I can already write more code. You know, it doesn't actually solve the problem.
Yeah. The other interesting, only other interesting thing about the sort certificate was that the full version of it gets really complicated because I allow your less than function to have state. Right, so that's it. So everything gets really ugly as to how to copy the certificate and maintain the state of not just begin and end, but the less than has state possibly, which it never does. But so it uses empty object base optimization stuff like that.
Into this in a real code base, which I don't think I ever have. We just use the default assert, but just at the top of any exported header file that was going to use an assert like macro, I would just say if and def assert.
I think a lot of things is a lot of people don't have this problem because they work in a code base, and that code base has its thing. I work in a whole bunch of different code bases that all have their own way of doing things, which
but
is
they can all pound upon assert,
yeah, they could fix their own assert. Yeah.
Well,
yes. I want to move on, but
one comment. Yeah. In Rust, they actually. Guarantee that strings are UTF-8.
Strings are UTF-8.
They end up, instead of having destructors in Rust, they don't have constructors, so they just have functions which return optional types or a result type that has you either get a string back or you get an error saying you had a UTF-8 error.
Right.
So I mean, I probably prefer that over this approach. Is saying just have a function that returns
use optional kind of stuff.
Optional.
Maybe. I've got 15 minutes, so I'm gonna. I had no idea whether I'd get through everything or even get through half of this, but speaking of errors, we could go on and on about errors and should you throw exceptions, should you do this, should you do that, all this stuff. I want to avoid a lot of those, but there's one thought I had about errors that I think is worthwhile. So we've probably all written code like this that, you know, oh, I'm going to check if that pointer is null or check something. And then it's like, okay, you've just bought into something because, well, what are you going to do if it's not, right? You've got to handle that somehow. Or you don't handle it. You consciously go, if it's not, we crash or something like that. But, you know, you put the check in there. So you've, you know, this is the general problem of what do I do about errors, right? I tend to go the opposite way of like check the error first and never get to the normal code, but whatever. We all have, you know, code that looks like these kind of things dealing with errors. And so I've tried to come up with my own definition of error just so that we're talking about the same thing. An error occurs when a function cannot complete its primary purpose. So that kind of covers cases of, well, this function, you know, square root, it's an error to pass in -1. You can make that a precondition and you can do, you know, can do undefined behavior. You can do whatever you want. You know, mine, maybe I return -1 on bad input. And yeah, it's not a very good square root function, but it's one of the fastest. If I take out the if, it's really, I have another square root function for numbers between 0 and 1. It returns 2/3. Figure out why 2/3 is the right answer, not like a half. But you know, it's a specialized function. That's why it's used for the special cases of between 0 and 1. That's what optimization is, right? It's like, oh, well, in this case, I can specialize. I can, yeah, and it's only somewhat wrong for other values. And like 2/3 between for numbers between 0 and 1 is really close a lot of times. So how much error do you accept for speed, right? Anyhow, you know, even though this function tells you exactly what it does on negative values and returns a result, and you could claim, well, therefore there's nothing wrong here that I'm using the square root of a negative value to negate a number. Because that's what the specification says it does, right? And it's like, no, okay, wait, sure you can do that, but that's not what we meant. And this is just, you know, I want to point out that however you do deal with errors, the primary purpose of the function was return square root. It could do a better job of doing the primary purpose, but I want to focus, primary purpose is to do what the function says it's going to do, and all the other stuff it says it will do on error cases are still not primary purpose. The function failed to do what its main point was. And a bug is an error that can only be fixed by fixing the code, changing the code, or changing the config file, or changing something that of the install package, right? Yeah. And so an error that's not a bug, I don't know what to call those really. One point is you can't tell which sometimes. So like you call open and it couldn't find the file not found. Is that an error or is that a bug? Well, it might be it's just a runtime error because the user typed in the wrong thing. Or maybe it's a bug because it was like hard-coded. This file should be part of the system and it's not there. Did I type the wrong file in? Like it's a bug in the code maybe or a bug in the installation. So I'm just going to call them expected and unexpected errors. Expected errors are the stuff your code handles. Unexpected errors are bugs that you have to change your code to deal with. Yes?
Standard terminology for this is runtime errors versus logic errors.
Yeah. Except for we have, so the standard term is runtime error versus logic error. Except for we have logic error exception, which means you're throwing exceptions on that you want people to handle, but it's a logic error. Yeah, but I agree. Maybe I should call them runtime error versus logic error. So the point, the insight in my head that I think is worthwhile is when you have an error, know your audience for who do I have to communicate this error to? And this whole bit of slides here, there's no code in this, it's just this kind of stuff. The people that you want to tell about an error is you. So assuming you're the guy who wrote the function or the library, maybe you've done a check and you're like, maybe that if pointer check was a member variable of your class, and you're like, I set pointer in the constructor, why is it null now? Like that's, my code is broken. And it's like, you know, why are you doing the check at all if you know that you set it in the constructor? But maybe you're just paranoid. You check your own code and like, something's wrong in my code internally. So I need to communicate that error back to me, the library author. Or that, you know, that pointer comes in or whatever, the guy passes in the wrong parameters to your function and you want to tell him you're making a coding error. So you want to tell the developer calling your code this is wrong, you shouldn't be calling me with this, it's a logic error. And the important part is that's different than telling the calling code that an error happened. Because when you want to tell the code an error happened, you expect that code to deal with the error somehow. And then some code, some errors, it propagates all the way back to the user as you typed in a file that I can't find or whatever, like, you know, something like that. And often, it's all of the above or many of the above, right? If it's an error in the calling code, you know, if you find an error in your code that was an expected error, file not found, you want to tell the calling code might decide to call the end user, tell the end user about it. Or as a function author, you find a bug in your own code. Maybe you just want to terminate. Well, you know what? Terminating is telling the end user something. You know, it's like, hey, program can't keep going. So you're often communicating to many of these things, but I think it's very important to know who's the primary person you're trying to communicate this error to. So if it's you, your own code that's somehow broken, and you've checked your code, and you're like, whoa, this was an assert in my code, like this should never happen, you maybe put in an assert, which is equivalent to undefined behavior probably in release, and maybe leads to a crash. Or maybe you terminate, but hopefully maybe you log something before you terminate so that you will eventually get that log file back from your end user to say, you know, the program crashed, here's this log, fix your code. Whereas if you're trying to communicate to the calling code, you're probably just throwing or returning an error value, or maybe it's an out parameter or something like that. And when you're returning to the calling developer, this is where people tend to get confused about how do I tell the developer that he did the wrong thing. And sometimes you throw, like in Java, null pointer exception, you just throw everything, right? Whether it's logic error or runtime error. The difference here is how you assert, in my mind. In the BlackBerry libraries, we have two different ways of logging errors, even like logic errors. We log our own internal errors to a system log. And because we're using Qt, we log developer errors through Q warning mechanism of Qt, which the developer can hook into and do whatever he wants with. But, you know, my internal errors, I need those to get to me. So I need to go to the system log, which can be sent back to me. And his errors, I don't really care about his errors. It's his fault. They need to get to him. And if he's running in debug or something, his debugger, whatever, will put those in his face, right? And I don't know. I just find it's really important to know, you know, oh, look, this pointer is null. Okay, great. How are you going to deal with that? First question is, who do you have to tell that this pointer is null? Because who you're telling is going to decide how you tell them. If it's like the calling code should understand that null could happen because it's an image processing library and you tried to allocate a giant image, well, that was kind of expected. That, you know, the allocation failed. You're telling the calling code. So you're not going to assert. You're going to use one of these mechanisms. And I don't know. I look at a lot of code that people wrote in my company, and it's like they deal with all errors as equal. It's like something went wrong. You know, log and return or something like that. And it's like, who are you trying to tell? That the calling code who made a mistake? Because that calling code's probably not going to deal with it very well because it didn't realize it made a mistake. Sometimes you still, I don't care if you decide that in this case, you're still going to tell the calling code because at the end of the day, you have to do something. The end user has to be informed. Like Adobe Premiere had a thing called panic save. If there was internal code went wrong and realized it because a precondition was violated, we still told the user because what we did, we put up a dialogue that says, something bad happened. We've saved your document over here to a separate file. We haven't modified your original document. We put the current one over there and we're going to close now. And then you should start us back up, look at the two documents and see which one's in better state. You know, like, because what else, you know, either that or you just crash and lose all his data. So at least it's like, well, we've tried, you know. Sorry we have a bug in our code, but, you know. That's my whole diatribe on, I have 5 minutes left, so maybe that's good, but yes?
In my experience, a lot of bugs occur from what I thought was an unexpected error actually being an expected error.
A lot of bugs that were...
Moving a lot of asserts because they actually can happen at runtime legitimately.
We have a great case of this in Adobe Premiere. Adobe Premiere had this somewhere in the file open or whatever. It asserted, you know, we had like contract assertions all like the preconditions and postconditions and different asserts for all the cases and stuff. So we had this assertion that the file name coming in to file open had to be a valid file name. You know, and it's like, well, maybe it checks the characters are, you know, proper file name characters or whatever. And then it's like, well, how do you check for proper file name characters? Every OS is different and all this. So all it checked was it's not empty. So, because an empty file name is not a valid file name. And, you know, a couple times it would happen that we'd get this assert firing, contact violation, because you called file open on an empty file. And you look at the code and it's like, just return file not found. It was an empty, you know, it's not really, because you go through the code. So now someone goes to the code, adds an if the file's not empty, then call file open, blah, 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 blah. And then that happened the fourth time, and then it happened the fifth time. So it got up to like 9 times that we found this assert firing because, hey, your code's wrong because you didn't check for an empty file name. It's like, at what point do you go, stop checking for that empty and just return file not found? Because the rest of the, you know, was it a bug in the calling code, or was it just, it would all work, every case, I looked at them all saying, every case, if you had just returned file not found, everything would have been fine. But we panic saved, closed the program down, and told the user something bad happened, you know, and all it was an empty file name. I was like, it looks really bad, and it wasn't anything that bad. And the same problem of, that's another pet peeve I have of code that decides to assert and shut down often doesn't know how important that code is. Are you essential code to this program? Or are you trying to find a bitmap in a button over here? Oh, you couldn't find the bitmap. Who really cares? You know, like, maybe that button's got text on it and the bitmap's not important. Like, there's so many cases where as a small piece of code at the bottom of the foundation, it's like, I don't know if this was important or not, but I'm going to assert and shut down the whole program? It's like, I also have this theory of your code was fine 3 steps, you know, 3 functions ago, everything was fine. It's, we have this idea of if you find something, an assertion fails, you can't trust anything because your code's in a bad state, you've done something wrong, don't do anything, just get out. But it's like, if you look at, I actually started doing this when I was at Adobe. I was going through all our check-ins, any check-in that said, fix the bug. I didn't go look at how the bug was fixed. I looked at what the bug was. It's like, what happened? And I didn't get enough time to do a full thing on this, but my initial reaction was all bugs happen in step 3. It's like, you come into a function, you check your inputs, oh yeah, you know, all the inputs are good, then you do some prep work and you call this other function of yours, and then you go, and it's like, and right about there, you forgot to check that function you just called. Yeah, sometimes it doesn't work because, you know, you just think, you're thinking everything's good, everything always, you know, the good case. And so the one thing was like, one function ago, everything was fine. And if you could just get out of here, things would be okay again. But you're worried because it's a programmer bug and you don't know the state of anything. So in theory, I don't like continuing after a programmer bug. In practice, it's almost always okay because you're in the middle of an operation. Like the user started with menu, do this, and just back out and you'll be back to, you didn't even touch the document. And obviously, these are things where it depends on what kind of code you're writing. Are you writing automatic trading and it's going to do $1 million trade? Or are you writing a word processor where it's like, yeah, you know, the guy's got a copy of his document, whatever. Yes?
Even if you're doing the automatic trading, as long as your recovery mechanism gets you out of the code that relies on the assertion,
yeah,
you're fine.
Yeah, if you can just get back a ways past where that, who needed that assertion?
How much of these problems do you think like stood expected and stood optional to solve? It seems to me that that's sort of what tries to delay like
how much of this can,
which the assertion occurs.
Yeah. How much of this can stood expected and stood optional solve? That's a big debate about whether a standard expected. Some people don't like it at all because it's like, we have exceptions. Why are you doing this? But it's in some ways it's useful to propagate errors. The one thing it won't, neither of them will solve, is programmers write bugs.
Well,
yeah. Yes.
You know, you're from Adobe. You know, if Adobe have removed all the assertion and all the error check, because it became like twice as fast as we right now. Well, how much CPU spend on searching and checking?
Well,
in
theory,
like you said,
yeah.
Empty is totally wasting CPU cycle.
Yeah.
Right?
In theory, some of those are only in debug. That's when you do performance measuring, right? I have stories of why Acrobat starts up so slowly. They're not that. There's other reasons for that. But like Adobe Premiere, for example, it's doing image processing all the time, right? And I remember when I used to write code and people would be like, this program's using 100% of your CPU. What a crappy program.
Whoa.
And then now it's like Adobe Premiere tries its hardest to use all 8 CPUs you have and rail them. It's like, that's what you bought this, you know, because if you're a video editor, you bought this PC to edit video. And that takes a lot of processing power. So if I'm not using your CPUs to full advantage, you wasted your money on those CPUs. So whenever you're doing stuff, it's rendering in the background, it's doing all this stuff. And those pieces of code are highly, I mean, there's pieces of code there written in assembly still, because it's like, this needs to be fast.
How to check anything.
Yeah, it's like, we're not checking, we've checked already, because like image processing, you check that there's an image and check some bounds and everything, but then you don't check on every pixel, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually one of my things is like, whenever people are saying, oh, this is gonna be slow, I always say, are you doing it on every pixel? And people look at me funny because I'm not talking about image processing sometimes, but it's still the same concept of, are you doing it on every single thing, or are you doing this once and, you know, then you iterate over thousands of things, right? Like, just put the checks in the right place.
I use a very small PDF reader because I try to read stuff at Adobe takes forever to load.
Yeah. Acrobat's its own.
Saying here, I always wonder, you guys have so many checks.
No, Acrobat has, that's another story. Yes?
I know for us, we have actually separate types of assertions.
Yeah.
Different assertion macros where.
Yeah, some assertions you leave on all the time. Some you say, this shouldn't be on in performance. And that's the Bloomberg way, too, of they have all these levels of how important is this insertion. Three levels?
Once you go past three, people don't reason about it. It becomes too complicated. They choose not to use the
yeah.
feature. So you
three,
keep it down to a simple
yeah,
set.
The three is a magic number. Is the so often. It's
we
the
ones that are on in testing, ones that aren't.
If, the same thing with every release of a product has three features. Doesn't matter if it's a dot release or a major release, it's three features. And then it's got this other stuff, but like in all the marketing of it, it's like, here's the three new things. And there's a bunch of, it's like, that's three is the optimal number for so many things. It's like, more than three, it's like, oh, I can't handle that. You know, less than three, it's like, give me more. Right?
There's three wise men.
three wise men, yeah. That's exactly. I'm gonna try to zoom through here. Testing, I've got two comments on testing. M plus N versus M times M is how you describe the standard library, standard template library, right? Stepping off separated structures from algorithms so that you don't have to, the combinatorics of how many algorithms we have to, if I had to write an algorithm for every structure and rewrite it for every structure, that would be way too much code. So he separated and is like, here's the algorithm. It works on a whole class of structures. And so instead of having m times n number of functions, you've got m plus n code, right? That's one of the beauties of the standard template library. I also use this in testing. So to me, this is the beauty of unit testing. Instead of testing, M times N is how you do functional testing of, I have to test all the combinations of how this code calls that code. That's, you know, a combinatoric problem. If I do unit testing, I test this code, and then I test that code. It's M plus M. And I actually use this for, when should I unit test? When should I separate these two pieces and test them as individual units versus, like, when I came up was, I've got code that just forwards this function call to the to the internal class or whatever. It's like, should I test that forwarding function separately? It's like, no, it's a one-to-one. There's no multiplicative combinatoric problem there. It's like, if the forwarding function works, the forwarding function works if the internal function works, and you can test them together because it's just, you don't have an M times N problem. You don't have to test those two things separately. And that's how I decide what things are units and what things aren't. So I don't know. I'm going to just fly past that. It's a little thing. So for me, it's not just for standard library. It's for unit tests. And my other thing is testing, just do it. I was writing this sort certificate, and this sort certificate thing turned into like my own version of range library. It got too big. And yeah, you know how that happens, right? So it's like 10,000 lines of code.
Checks.
The 10,000 lines, it's 5,000 lines of test code and 5,000 lines. It's actually more test code than real code, but almost half and half, test code versus library, all header files, header code. But it compiles in a couple of seconds, and the test suite runs in half a second. So I used to have this pattern of whenever I write some code, and I, you're thinking about some code, and you write it, and you go, yeah, I think that's going to work. You hit save. I got, nowadays it's not so bad because a lot of IDEs will save automatically and everything, but I got in this habit of, as soon as I type anything, like three lines, and I think that might be good, hit save, right? It was just this pattern I have. Now I hit run. I type three lines of code, hit run. See, do my tests still pass? I'll write one line of test code. Hit run, because running the test case takes seconds. It's no time. And the funny thing about it all, when I started writing this test suite, I was like, what test framework should I use? There's all these different testing frameworks. And I looked at some of the standard libraries, how they do their testing. And a lot of them were just main, create a vector, do a pushback, assert something, exit. No test suite. There's no test framework. It's just, the program crashes or not. And I was like, yeah. And it's like, just write. I don't care what test framework. I don't care anything. Just write tests. So I just started writing test code. And I started building my own little framework out of it. But the important part was it doesn't matter. Just write anything, any kind of test. Just and if you make it nice and small and keep your code separate from a giant, Adobe Premiere took hours to test. But it's like, take your piece of code, write it in its own little thing, and test that, and you can run your tests in a couple of seconds. And it's beautiful. I just hadn't written my code that way before. And I was just like, I test every few minutes. I write some code. Run, does it even compile? And if you're going to spend the trouble to figure out whether it compiled, it's no extra time to figure out whether the tests work. So it's literally half a second to run the test. This was my link bait in my description of this talk. One simple rule to write better code now. No raw loops. I thought I was going to finish early and then have a lot of time part of this slide is supposed to be, I would like to hear your one rule. If you only had one rule to go by that you could take with you to your desert island of, you can only have one rule with you, what would it be? We're kind of running out of time, but my one rule is, I was writing some code the other day and it was bad. It was, I'm writing it, and the thing is, it works. It's just bad. I'm looking at this code, it's like, I hate this code. And it does its job, it works. So it's like, so I rewrote it, and it was still bad. It was like, I'm like, is it just that this is a hard problem, or like, and it's just like, no, I don't have the right pieces yet. I want, and it's a difference of like, sometimes you just write code, I just want to see something work. But it's like, the thing is that I don't think the problem is that people can't write good code. Because I think we all look at code and go, that's bad code. You could just look at it and go, that code's bad. And hey, it works, so let's just keep going. And my one simple rule for writing better code is don't keep going. Just stop and go, yes, I realize that code is bad, so I'm going to rewrite it, even though the code works. And of course, the problem there is you've got deadlines and all this stuff. And the other problem being of, when do you decide that I don't care if this code's bad. This code sits over here, and it runs this dialogue, and it doesn't really matter if that code's bad. Versus this code is the core of this piece of product, and it needs to work well because we're going to build on top of it. And that's what I was writing. I was writing this core piece of code, and I had to keep writing it because, it was just really bad code. So I have this theory that we all know what bad code looks like. It's hard to describe, but when you see bad code, well, change it. You write good code. Like, how do you write good code? Write bad code until you stop saying, that was bad. Write it again. That was bad too. Write it again. Hey, look, that's good. I don't know. It's part of it is just, there's a theory of just hack up some stuff and do iterative development, and it'll get better over time. But I find that you never get to make it better over time. So it's like, I would push for take the time.
Yeah,
tell your manager, screw off. I'm taking the time to write some good code for a change. And that's my, you know, it's not really a one simple rule. My one simple rule is, you know, write better code. Just that code doesn't look good. Okay, write some better code. Okay, yeah, I would love to hear people's rules for your one rule, but tell me later. Are there any quick question, anyone?
We can take like one question.
Perfect. Thank you.